Chapter 2. All children, except one, grow up, and all children, except one, are born of woman. In the spring of 1945, a fetus-like infant was retrieved from an open-air sewer beneath a public toilet in a slum in the Lorong village of Jakarta. He was named Franciscus, meaning freed from filth. And from the first moment of his existence, and in spite of his squalid genesis, he demonstrated an unparalleled genius. At first, there was a moment of crying, then cooing, very shortly followed by clear linguistic utterances. By the time the authorities arrived some hours later, he was writing quadratic equations on the wall in his own excrement. Excrement on walls was nothing new to the locals, and explaining them in Aramaic to the crowd which had gathered. For the next 2 weeks, he was taken in by a family of 28 running a local temple. They lived over a fetid brown creek with the smell of a pig farm, and there he was fed and clothed and loved. Because of his brilliant mind and progressive knowledge, he was quickly treated as a god in the village, and people would line up to pet his head in the hope of having knowledge imparted to them. He thrived in the grime of his environment, growing rapidly in stature and intellect, and soon had the appearance of a toddler while engineering sanitation, transport systems, and birth control for the whole community. This way, he no longer needed to circumcise the women. Word spread quickly about Franciscus, and soon the Indonesian military were on where his doorstep would be if the temple had a doorstep. There was much wailing and moaning as the young prodigy was ripped from their arms, and a torrent of semi-naked bodies followed along the vehicles as they departed, banging on the windows and doors and begging them to return him to them. Their hopes were never realized. They were gunned down, all of them, the temple family, their neighbors, and all who had come out to protest. Their bodies piled as high as horses' shoulders, or as far as the eye could see. "Salang Kalamangkeng," a soldier yelled at the families. This was not Indonesian. He had a speech impediment. Franciscus was taken to a top-secret facility deep in the mountains where, after a brief period of quarantine, so-called experts, though they had never seen anything of Franciscus's like before, began to feed his voracious curiosity, intellect, and abilities. They were in awe. They began with little golden books and tic-tac-toe, but were, before long, working on James Joyce and global thermonuclear warfare. Apart from the odd foray into hentai and erotic art, Franciscus adhered strictly to academic and ethical pursuits. Scientists from all over the world began to hear rumors of this prodigy, and would try to arrange secretive visits to Franciscus's cell. There, the lucky few would marvel over the possibilities he brought into the world. Was he a god? They wondered. A mutation? Should he be encouraged or stopped? Their audience with Franciscus was inevitably inspiring and humbling, and was often coupled with an intoxicating agenda. Despite the highly classified nature of the project to which Franciscus was now referred, and the isolated location of its facilities, one day, several months into operations, a blonde-haired man in a very dark suit turned up unannounced at the front gate. He flashed some identification and was escorted into the heart of the complex. There, he was introduced to the overseer of the program, looking his Indonesian colleague in the eye with a curious expression that could have been mistaken for contempt. He removed his spectacles and raised a palm. "Heil Hitler!" In the summer of that year, the Pacific War was brought to an end with two cataclysmic explosions. They destroyed everyone and everything for miles around and left a simmering, scorching layer of radiation to last for the ages. The lucky ones were those right under the detonations who were immediately reduced to ashes and outlines etched in concrete. It was those who survived the initial blasts who learned the true meaning of suffering. They wandered about aimless, hopeless, with melting flesh, groping about in near or total blindness for help. None came, and that which did came too late, and with little or no means of alleviating their agony. The torture was not short-lived. For years, even decades to come, those who had been exposed to the radiation suffered numbness, loss of fingernails, blood spots under the skin, tumors, leukemia, kidney and liver dysfunction, and so on. The list of after-effects was almost endless, and for those who suffered from them, so was the pain. Such widespread and severe affliction hastened the surrender of the Japanese forces, and with the capitulation of the other Axis powers earlier in the year, the ceasing of worldwide hostilities was now complete. For the general populace, exhausted and depleted, they couldn't have come soon enough, and with the exception of a couple of skirmishes in Guam and a few other remote areas, peacetime was welcomed by victor and loser nations alike with great relief and vigor. But not by all. Not everyone was pleased with either the outcome of the war or the means by which it had been achieved. There were some who believed that the Axis powers still retained the ability, the manpower, and most of all, the technological savvy to inflict revolutionary damage to the Allied forces and alter not merely the outcome of the war, but both history and the future together. SanCorp was one such organization, a secretive, privately owned Japanese company based in Okinawa. It was bitterly opposed to the Japanese surrender and continued to work unabated in technological, ideological, and biological warfare. Though the rest of the country labored in poverty, SanCorp remained flush with funds for its operations. A little known fact regarding the end of the war in the European theater concerns the demise of the Führer. In that bunker in Berlin just before he put the pistol to his temple, Hitler uttered his final words, "Gib alles zu SanCorp." Give everything to SanCorp. As such, the Okinawan company had available to them near unlimited resources from war loot and retained communication with its sister allies in Germany and Italy to pursue its goals of supremacy. Given these objectives, one could hardly overstate the joy that reverberated along their corridors when they received word from the fatherland that a new resource of immeasurable capacity had been secured. And so it was that Franciscus was removed from Indonesia at a very young age and transported to Okinawa, where he was to spend the remainder of his adolescent years. There, his name was shortened to Frank, because the Japanese seemed incapable of pronouncing the Siskus part of his name, and he was put in a lab working toward various means of Axis domination. This enigma of a young man grew to about 180 centimeters tall and developed a well-defined body, thanks to chasing monkeys and boars around the lab whenever they escaped, which was often. He would wrestle them to the ground or knock them out, sometimes with the aid of a porcelain sink, a trick he had learned from a Slav. He had a shock of thick black hair, which gave him an aura of tremendous virality. He wore silver wire-framed glasses upon a nose that had more than once identified him as having Jewish ancestry, an association he vehemently denied. And he always wore the same blue shirt. It had never been washed. Frank's secluded upbringing gave him a peculiar perspective on the world. He tended to see people and events in extremes. He divided folk into creators and consumers, leaders and followers, thinkers, dumbasses, and bullies and their prey. No one really sat in between any of these paradigms. People were either one or the other, and once they were, it was virtually impossible to change to the other. Frank saw himself as the consummate creator, leader, thinker, bully in almost any environment he found himself in. And then there was his voice. Much had been hypothesized about the raspiness of Frank's voice and why it came to be so. Some have assumed it to be purely genetical anomaly. Others are certain it is the result of a bacterial infection caught from any number of the animals he was experimenting on. On occasion, Frank told people that it was from swallowing thumbtacks after losing a bet in a drunken stupor. But the truth of the matter is that, for a short stint in Frank's formative years, he took to singing Christian heavy metal, a phase he quickly grew out of to the relief of everyone in the lab and the local area. But the constant shrieking and growling took its toll on poor Frank's virgin vocal cords, and alas, they never fully recovered. Young Frank had interests and ideals that extended way beyond the walls of the lab. He was fascinated with midgets and aliens and black people in Paris. He found unusual dialects from the Congo, Peru, and the bowels of Southeast Asia to be of particular interest. Rap and opera filled his musical library, and he developed a particular distaste for non-Japanese who attempted to infiltrate Japanese society, professing an edge of the culture whilst demonstrating a profound ignorance of it. There were many artisans and thinkers, musicians and poets who inspired him, but none more than Schrödinger and some guy named Mozart, who down the line would become the ancestor of Fred Durst. Biologically speaking, Frank himself was, turned out, an even more mysterious figure than his filthy origins would suggest. Though dredged up from an Indonesian sewer, DNA testing revealed that he was primarily of Japanese and German extraction. This explains some inherent traits in Frank's life, like his insatiable appetite for takoyaki, sudden bowing, and a penchant for Ragio Taiso early in the morning. On the kraut side, Frank would immerse himself in bratwurst diets for weeks on end, find secret relief in listening to recordings of the Umpa Pa bands of Munich, and was without any sense of humor. Yet there were other genetic markers in his DNA that were unidentifiable, and it was these which started the rumors and fears amongst his colleagues in the lab. There was only one man that Frank answered to in the lab, and that was Tsubasa Honda. Honda was a graduate from Tokyo University who excelled in bioengineering. He originally joined the Imperial Army because, nurturing the psychopath within, he wanted to create bioweapons to see what happens with them. A quietly spoken man, he was once well-built, yet now rather rotund as he approached middle age. He almost became a professional baseball player before the war, primarily because smashing things with a bat was a marvelous release for someone who was otherwise extremely reserved, yet he quit baseball at the last minute because he didn't want to give in to a dirty American tradition. When the war came to its fireball end, Honda was offered a job at Suncorp, a position he received with enthusiasm and gratitude as, philosophically, it involved continuing service to the Emperor, and in practical terms, it involved destroying things. His relationship to Frank was simple. In awe of Frank's genius and his moral failures, his job was to leave Frank alone to do the work that he had been specifically employed to do, and to question neither the Germans nor the Japanese board of Suncorp about it. In this sense, Honda was the perfect supervisor for Frank. Loyal yet without ethics, nationalistic yet without any sense of restraint, and brilliant without any desire to use it for the greater good. There were 15 other employees in the lab to clean and to perform mundane duties, but to Frank they were all faceless drudges, as boring as a feminist at a dinner party, and about as funny as a fart in church. Yet there was one presence in that facility who stood out to Frank, and who became very nearly the sole focus of his attention. His name was Ichiro. Ichiro mattered. Not in the sense that he was important or intelligent or helpful. On the contrary, Ichiro was a useless idiot. He was the very antithesis of Frank, the consuming dumbass follower type who was prey for Frank's inner bully. He was the necessary evil in Frank's small world, and Frank worked him without mind or mercy. A little contemptuous man with a basketball head and round glasses, he looked like some kind of bootleg Japanese Harry Potter doll you would win at a second-rate carnival. He had "Kick Me" written all over his fat, poxy face. Simply put, he looked fucking retarded. Ichiro was Frank's whipping boy, his dog, his right-hand wiper. In almost every sense of the word, Ichiro was Frank's bitch. This explains why Frank never referred to him by the name his mother gave him at his sorry birth, but called him, without exception, Bichiro. Whenever Frank needed someone to mop up spillage, he called for Bichiro. Whenever Frank wanted someone to pick up the pieces of a rat, he would bellow for Bichiro. If he needed a bottle to piss in, Bichiro would hold it at the ready.
Bichiro, hand me the generator. Bichiro, pick up that spleen. Bichiro, stick that knife into the toaster.
With every command, Bichiro would bow and scrape and respond with, "My nama Bichiro." And whenever Frank defecated, he would watch as his turd was flushed away and say, "Goodbye, Bichiro." The laboratory itself was like no other. A perfectly square gray building, it looked like a run-down Japanese public school. There was nothing in its design to please or inspire, save for a few palm trees which grew on the boundaries of the property. Rising up behind it was a mountain range, covered in Jurassic vegetation and still unclassified fauna. It teemed with monkeys, boar, and habu snakes, yet most of its natural resources remained undiscovered. The building contained three floors. With the top floor at the treetop height, vines and other vegetation ran along the outside wall of the lab, weaving in and out of the windows and ventilation systems which no longer worked. The sultry air was a perfect incubator for all this foliage, and a common source of fatigue amongst the employees on any given afternoon. The top floor was all Frank's, and he was given unfettered access to complete his tasks. It contained line after line of computers and various other equipment, most of which no one, other than Frank, knew how to operate. But Frank, with an intellect that itself was fast approaching singularity, ran them all with ease and with distinction. His preferred fields of research were diverse, including bacteriology, horology, pharmacology, biochemistry, cosmology, endocrinology, spectroscopy, hematology, mycology, and of course, gelatology. But if there were a pet area of research and design that meant more to Frank than any other, it was radiobiology. That is, the study of the action of ionizing radiation on living things. As such, the lab was strewn with cages containing, or which contained, animals of all sizes and kinds. Primates, birds, reptiles, amphibians, insects were all loved equally for their willingness to serve a greater good. Presently, a small newt set gingerly in the corner of a clear container, occasionally looking up at Frank as its god and scratching its chest. And then there were the rats. Frank hated rats with a passion, and found a great pleasure in reserving his most terrifying experiments for them. Some moved about in their confinement with knowing concern, while others were no longer able to, and some were no more than organs or appendages on a table. On more than one occasion, Frank would tie a rat to three or four pigeons, then release them to the skies. The pigeons would fly off in different directions, tugging the rat back and forth in midair. The rat would be writhing and screaming. The birds would be scared to death of the noise the rat was making and fly even harder, which made the rat's screams reach fever pitch. And so the circus would go on till it came to its grisly demise. Frank would just shrug and chuckle. These episodes marked the beginning. Indeed, the socially repressive lab life began to take its toll on Frank. He would drink copious amounts of beer and then abuse the animals in the lab for what he claimed was a node. He would disappear for hours on end in the evenings to go to dogfights, cockfights, bullfights, and midget boxing. He would drunkenly harass the hookers in the red light district, yelling, "I got Molly, I got White," and "Gang, gang, free my nigger goo wop," while being dragged away by the police and or the off-base US military. In short, while Frank was a genius and a biological phenomenon, his environment was making him filthy. Yet the greater change was from within. Frank had been pouring his heart and soul into radiobiology, and all the while unwittingly, he poured radiobiology into his genetic vulnerabilities. The interaction of radiation on the unknown genetic markers in Frank's DNA brought about changes which Frank could never have imagined. Dark changes, menacing changes, changes that reached far further than Frank could ever have imagined. At first it was just aches and pains, but then his urine turned orange and he began to have hallucinations. Sometimes happy, sometimes terrible, always weird. Aware of these changes, Frank decided to secretly test himself, certain that he now had some form, or forms, of cancer. It was not without fear, then, that he lay the syringe on the table, sterilized his arm with a swab of alcohol, and slapped his skin to bring up the veins. On finding the best one, he slipped the needle in and watched the red essence fill the test tube. He filled a second just in case. Before the blood on his arm had dried, he had the sample mixed with testing solutions and placed under a microscope. There, to his horror, he watched nucleic acids behave in a way that he had never seen before. They were wriggling, writhing, and then pulling apart as though in self-rejection, before completely splitting down the middle, the process which appeared to be repeating ad infinitum. This discovery made cancer look like the common cold. With cancer, the cells multiply uncontrollably. With Frank, his chromosomes were now multiplying uncontrollably. He was, in effect, becoming an entirely new species. He continued to look into the eyepiece wondering, hoping that this was another hallucination. He called his little rodent friend over to confirm the findings.
"Bachiro, get over here!"
He was in front of Frank immediately.
"Look into this microscope and tell me what you see."
"My name is Bicho."
"Well, what do you see? Don't hold back. Tell me everything."
The simpleton began to sweat and looked decidedly nervous.
"So you see it too?"
Frank asked.
"You see the chromosomes multiplying?"
Bichiro could no longer control his bladder.
My name is Bichiro.
Frank turned away in distress for a moment, then looked back to his underling and held out a stern finger.
"No one hears about this, Bichiro. You got that? No one is to know."
My name is Bichiro.
"If anyone at all gets wind of this, I will stir you up and serve you with fries while you're still breathing."
My name is Bichiro.
"Now what are you still doing here? Piss off!"
The weasel scampered off with one last, "My name is Bichiro." Frank diligently took samplings every morning and evening and kept daily notes on the progress of his condition. What he failed to do, however, primarily because he just didn't care, was test Bichiro, who had also been regularly exposed to the uranium.
"Bichiro, bring me that sea cucumber,"
he called to him one fine morning.
My name is Bichiro.
Frank looked at his little dolt as he held the dripping echinoderm in his trembling hands. Bichiro looked different this morning. He had an aura of greater patheticness, greater nervousness, as though he was expecting to be beaten far greater than he had ever been beaten before. Frank enjoyed this enormously.
"What?"
said Frank.
"Spit it out, boy. What in the name of scat is wrong with you?"
And before he could get any more out, his head jerked back in such a violent manner, the crack in his neck could be heard down on the second floor. With a sound like the branch of a tree breaking, his jaw and mouth ripped apart with such incredible force that the crown of his head began to split open. There was a momentary resistance before Bichiro's entire body, from his head down to the base of his torso, ripped in two, and a new naked and slimy Bichiro emerged, slithering out of what was now a crumpled carcass lying on the floor. Said Frank.
Cool.
He then turned to continue on his own testing.
My name is Bichiro.
Said this new Bichiro, identical to the previous one, though still covered in a thick slime.
Yeah, I know.
Said Frank.
Now piss off.
This metamorphosis was not a singular event. In fact, Bichiro fast fell into a natural routine of excruciating death and slimy rebirth once a week or so, and Frank, more amused than concerned in any way at all, would take fastidious notes each time it happened. His concern remained more for himself. He knew that he and Bichiro were changing. The only difference was that no one cared about Bichiro. And as soon as Bichiro had completed a metamorphosis, Frank would tell him to hurry and clean up the mess he had made on the floor and to incinerate the putrid carcass that he always left behind.